This morning, before we begin, I want to remind everyone that today we have a guest preacher, Father Daniel Aid, who is my colleague in Los Angeles, who is also going to be consulting with our vestry on issues of the property. So we welcome Father Dan to be with us this morning as our preacher. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
You. Let us pray. O God, who before the passion of your only begotten Son revealed his glory upon the holy mountain, grant to us that we, beholding by faith the light of his countenance, may be strengthened to bear our cross and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The first reading is from Exodus. When our first reading starts, Moses has received the Ten Commandments. Now he's called to ascend the holy mountain again. So we again hear the story of this ancient epiphany, this manifestation of God to humankind. The numbers 7 and 40 have a mystical meaning in the Old Testament, but they do not necessarily indicate specific time periods. A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait there, and I will give you the tablet of stone with the law and the commandment, which I have written for their instruction." So Moses set out with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. To the elders he had said, "Wait here for us until we come to you again, for Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute may go to them." Then Moses went up onto the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. On the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. Moses was on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will read responsively Psalm 2 found in your bulletin. Why are the nations in an uproar? Why do the peoples mutter empty threats?
Why do the kings of the earth rise up in revolt, and the princes plot together against the Lord and against his anointed?
Let us break their yoke, they say. Let us cast off their bonds from us.
He whose throne is in heaven is laughing. The Lord has them in derision.
Then he speaks to them in his wrath, and his rage fills them with terror.
I myself have set my king upon my holy hill of Zion.
Let me announce the decree of the Lord, he said to me. You are my son. This day have I begotten you.
Ask of me, and I will give you the nations for your inheritance, and the ends of the earth for your possession.
You shall crush them with an iron rod and shatter them like a piece of pottery.
And now, you kings, be wise. Be warned, you rulers of the earth.
Submit to the Lord with fear, and with trembling bow before him.
Lest he be angry and perish, for his wrath is quickly kindled.
Happy are they all who take refuge in him.
The author of our second reading was not the Apostle Peter, but he adopts Peter's authority by citing the story of the Transfiguration and claiming that he was there when it happened. He uses Peter's name to make a point about the authority of Christian scripture, that it comes not from our own will, but through the power of the Holy Spirit. We did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, but we had been eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received honor and glory from God the Father when that voice was conveyed to him by the majestic glory, saying, "This is my Son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice come from heaven while we were with him on the holy mountain. So we have the prophetic message more fully confirmed. You will do well to be attentive to this as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. First of all, you must understand this, that no prophecy of scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation, because no prophecy ever came by human will, but men and women moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
6 days after Peter had acknowledged Jesus as the Christ, the Son of the living God, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, "This is my Son, the Beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the true and living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
It's good to be with you this morning. Today we stand at the gates of Lent. And there are things about Lent that we're quite comfortable with, and there are things that we're just not comfortable with at all, because it gets in the way of our sense of permanence. I had a job, part of my job, I had wonderful employment at a parish in Manhattan, but there was a part of that, I was given an assignment that I thought, this is the worst job I have ever had. But it turned out to be the best job, because it utterly changed the way that I think about Lent, the season ahead, and the vexing question of my own mortality. You know, there in the ordination rite of the Episcopal Church, there's a whole moment where the bishop, he or she, tells the ordinand, well, this is what you're going to do, and it's all the things that we think a priest should do. You're going to preach, you're going to teach, you're going to visit the sick, you're going to care for people no matter who they are or where they're from. You're going to baptize, you're going to celebrate the sacraments. But at the end, there's a dangerous, dangerous line that most priests in the joy of the day forget. It says that you will take up ministrations that are under your care. It's sort of a grab bag of all kinds of things that as a priest you're not trained to do. And you find yourself doing things that you have no knowledge about or any skill set at or just trained in any way. But usually you have to depend on the knowledge of the people in the pews to teach you as you move along. There are many, many things that a priest does that have nothing to do with being dressed like this. And this job that I was given, which I thought was the worst, was like that. The parish where I worked had just installed a columbarium, and we were meeting with the man who was building the columbarium, and he explained to my boss and I that most people will buy an urn for their loved ones, but it will not fit in the columbarium. So unless you're their counsel beforehand, you have to transfer the ashes from the urn into this sort of mailbox type thing that, that columbariums have. And so the fellow said, you know, you will have to get someone to do that. And my boss just said, oh, Father Dan will do that. And I said, I will? Oh, I can't do that. I can't do that. And he very correctly said to me, it is a priestly job. It is a priestly job. And I quickly learned that it was a priestly job, and that my anxiety was placed in the wrong place. My anxiety was placed upon the dead, and it should have been placed on the living. Because what I learned is what we all have. We have a difficulty confronting the idea of our own mortality. And so the people who actually were thinking ahead enough to buy niches in the columbarium had all sorts of this worldly issues to deal with, that they weren't focused so much on resurrection hope, but today. There were lots of, where am I going to be? I mean, the columbarium had real estate, and there was I don't want to be way up high, and I don't want to be really low, because I want people to see me. I want them to read my name. I want them, I want to be remembered. I want to be remembered. We want to be remembered. And then there were just sort of silly, broken things that exhibited the brokenness of humanity and our need for healing. There was a lot of interest in who would be next to you. Oh, no, I can't be next to him. Absolutely not. I had one person move three times, and I finally had to say to him, sir, this is a columbarium. It's not a gated community. When you die, you're going to be lost in a worship that you can't even begin with. You won't care. It's all okay. But we can't let go of the things of this life. So I learned things equally from the dead and from the living. There was a woman there who bought a niche. I'll talk about that in a minute. She absolutely changed the way that I look at Ash Wednesday and the rest of Lent. But in the meantime, what I learned is this. I transferred the ashes of somebody who was 100 years old. I transferred the ashes of someone who was 2 days old. I transferred the ashes of people who were rich, of people who were poor, of people who were very faithful, and of people who were not. I transferred the ashes of people who were every race. Here's what I learned. It's the hard truth. As our prayer book says, we all go down to the dust. No matter who you are, you become a bag of dust at some point. But thanks be to God, we don't have our end there. The woman who taught me so much bought a niche, and she said, I don't care where it is, but I need to know where it is. And she put her name on the niche, her name and her birth date. And this was in a very public place where people, out those doors there, where people walked to the coffee hour every Sunday. And I said, isn't that hard for you? I don't think I could do that. And she told me something I never will ever forget. She said, it is hard, but it keeps me grounded in gratitude. So what we're doing next Wednesday is not sort of a place of our beating ourselves up. Yes, it's an examination of our lives, but it's recognizing that God has actively changed the human condition. What we proclaim is that God is active in the human condition, changing us from where we might have ended up to the new life that we have. All from the brokenness of the Garden of Eden to the new life of the garden on Easter morning, God is actively changing. God is actively intercepting our fate. God is actively intercepting the fate of someone that you think you've lost, because you haven't. God is actively proclaiming life. God is an activist. There is a place where each and every one of us someday will, our remains will rest. It's somewhere on the face of the earth, both for you and for me. But our end is not there. God has actively changed that. So when we wear the ashes on Ash Wednesday, it is a time of penitence, but also you're marking yourself as a person who is living in gratitude. It's a hard question. We're utterly comfortable asking people, so what are you taking on or giving up for Lent? But we would never ask somebody, how are you confronting your mortality this Lent? Well, you might now, but that's what's at the core of what we're talking about, that God has actively changed what is going to happen to us, is what is going to happen to the people we love. And that activist God who's changing people's lives is actively changing the death of communities into life. You can't believe that God is actively changing your life without believing that God is changing communities' life. God is actively proclaiming life here, today. It's not for some bygone time, someday. It's now. And so the gratitude we have is lived out not just on Wednesday, but every day, that God has seized your life. God has seized the life of the people you love. God has offered us everything. Everything. What else can we be but grateful? So this Lent, take on something or give something up. That's up to you. But focus on cultivating gratitude for what God has done, for the miracle of life that God has proclaimed in your life, in my life, and in the life of this congregation. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have created us out of the dust of the earth. Grant that the ashes we will receive this week may be a sign of our mortality and penitence, that we may remember it is only by your gracious gift that we are given everlasting life. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead
and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. We pray especially for Hank, Peter, Bob, Mark, MB, Marion, Clay, Kai, Frank, Mark, Michael, Kimberly, Tina, Carol, Sue D, Todd, Einstein, Danny M, Pamela, Nat and Nancy, Jude, Sue B, Elsie, Sue M, Sally, MC, David, Jerry, Bruce, Pearl, James, Dawn, Macy, Mother Lauren, Katie, Pam, Peg, Carol W, Roy, Bruno, Doug, Carol, Alan Michael, Leah, Ryan, Michelle, James, all those suffering as a result of natural and human-made disasters, especially the earthquake victims in Turkey and Syria. All of those injured due to gun violence, especially at Michigan State University, and all those affected by COVID-19. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless, O Lord, physicians, nurses, first responders, and all others who minister to the suffering, granting them wisdom and skill, sympathy and patience. We pray especially for Dr. Elizabeth Engelman, Dr. Dan Griffin, Dr. Esther E. Knapp, Dr. Rachel Simpson, Karen Liu, Eva Longmire, Brenda Marshall, Susan Dietz-Massengill, Kat Bates, Narina Guerra, and all those responding to natural and human-made disasters. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. We pray especially for Francis Caputo, Sister Mary Jean of the community of St. Mary's East, all those who have perished so far in the war in Ukraine, those who have died as a result of natural and human-made disasters, especially the earthquake victims in Turkey and Syria, those killed as a result of gun violence, especially at Michigan State University, and the millions worldwide who have died from COVID-19, and those we remember in the stillness of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Please be seated for a couple of brief announcements. Again, our welcome to Father Dan, who is with us today. Lots of things going on this week as we prepare for the beginning of Lent. 6 p.m. on Tuesday, there will be a pancake supper. All you can eat pancakes, just like IHOP. And that's going to be led by the youth of the parish, I believe, isn't it? That's going to be Tuesday evening at 6 p.m. And then, of course, the next day is Ash Wednesday. There will be two services for Ash Wednesday, one at noon and one at 7:30 p.m. I encourage you to come that evening or that noonday as your schedule permits. This is the day when we really begin our walk into the season of Lent, and we are marked, as Father Dan noted, with the sign of our own mortality, ashes. But to know that we are people of hope as we walk the path of Lent towards the Holy Week and towards Easter morning. And so I invite you to be with us on Ash Wednesday at either noon or 7:30 p.m., and I believe at noon it will also be live streamed. Next Sunday, we're also going to be beginning Christian education after this service. We're going to be doing a class that I'm calling Remembering Who We Are. And it's going to be just like basically the basic things about Christianity, what it is that we really believe as Christians, and go through the whole story of the Bible. And so that when we come to Holy Week and Easter, we can affirm that faith in the death and the resurrection of Christ and understand who we are as a result of all of that. So I encourage you, invite you to come to that class starting after this service next Sunday. It will be downstairs in the St. Cecilia room. And come be part of that group that will be meeting during the five Sundays of Lent, starting next Sunday and going up through the fifth Sunday of Lent. Not on Palm Sunday, but through the five Sundays of Lent before that. Also today, there will be healing prayers offered and available right at the pulpit here after communion, during communion. So I invite you to come if you would like. If there's some need in your life for which you want prayer, invite you to come and do that at communion time. Is there anyone here today who has a birthday or an anniversary? Oh, that are on the Zoom, Mark and Carol. Let's wave to Mark and Carol. And that's an anniversary, Rupali?
Yes.
Great.
We have a birthday as well.
And we have a birthday here.
Oh,
wonderful. Stand up. There we are. So together let us pray the birthday prayer and the anniversary prayer today. Watch over those who are celebrating their birthdays, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts, may your peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of their lives, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May God bless you and grant you joy. May he deepen your love for each other. May he bless you in your family and friends and lead you to unending happiness in heaven. May God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless us all and keep us all in his love forever and ever. Amen. Now walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For by water and the Holy Spirit you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn, to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
that we have been given, let us pray. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.